Hello YouTube, so this is my general guide here of how to install air conditioning into a Toyota pickup. This is mainly for the 1984 to 1988 model year trucks, and 4Runners are also basically the same, all the way up to 95. Same with pickups, they are basically the same, not identical, but Toyota made these trucks very easy to install air conditioning in. Anyways though, this is my old rusty piece of shit, and it's currently being built into something fairly decent, but as it sits right now, it is ugly as shit with 8,000 problems. Anyways though, so we're going to go ahead and start under the hood here, because it's really simple. Now, air conditioning, it's not too hard to do it right. You need some tools, a gauge set, you can get a cheapie off of Amazon for about $30. Vacuum pump, an electric one, they're around $70 on Amazon, $100 at Harbor Freight, or you can rent them. Don't bother with the air-operated ones, they are garbage. But anyways though, so here we are. Under the hood. We'll start at the front here, rip the grill off, and here where the condenser goes, and the receiver dryer. So, they're simple. There's a bolt here, here, there, and there. Line comes in here, goes to the compressor manifold down there. This liquid line runs across here, through the back, up, and into the firewall, to the evaporator assembly. There's supposed to be a tab that bolts here and here. I think it was an original condenser. This one doesn't have it anymore. It's been swapped out for a newer type. And then dryer mounts here. There's a nut on the back there and another one down there behind it. And this little line here is a loop on in. Now, parts that you can't get new for these anymore, you can get a condenser. Both the rubber hoses, the evaporator core, the expansion valve, and even the pressure switch all inside of a dash. This line, discontinued. This one runs along the firewall, discontinued. This one here, there's a loop in the condenser, discontinued. The brackets are also discontinued. Now here's the original condenser, and here's the reason why it's not being used. One, this delaminated. That affects heat transfer, so it won't get as cold. Two, these are more designed for R12. This is a serpentine unit. Basically, it's this tube with like five channels in it. There's a big S all the way to the bottom where it comes out there. This is a parallel flow. It kind of has these tanks on the side here. And it has a bunch of super small passages in there, and it works better with heat transfer for R134A, which the system is using, even though I haven't put adapter fittings on it. So, then the other hose here, this is the suction line, it runs into there. And this truck, I put a brand spanking new compressor on it. We run for Denso, but I tried a reman that I actually pulled from the pick and pull that was put in a Corolla. It's the same style as the factory compressor. I even put a new shaft seal on it because it looked like it was leaking. And it promptly started leaking out of the one of the case seals on the compressor. I got mad, said fuck it, went to AutoZone. Believe it or not, they had this on the shelf. So my wallet is now $350 lighter, which really hurt, but this is a brand spanking new compressor, so hopefully it doesn't leak, and hopefully it just works. Now these brackets, there are, to my knowledge, four or five different style of factory 22RE AC compressors from 1984 on. There's even older styles, but once you got to the really early trucks, that's when AC was fairly rare and 8,000 aftermarket styles existed. The pickups use a smaller compressor than the 4Runner. The brackets aren't the same, but if you have the right bracket, you can make it work. This is a 10P13C. There's the 15C, which is the slightly larger 4Runner compressor. You get the right. You just need to make sure you line up the right compressor with the right bracket. And the newer ones hit a 10PA15 compressor, which it will mount onto like either the old style bracket or the newer style one that will fit, but the pulley won't line up, so you can't actually, you know, use it. So this is a 13 style compressor bracket. These were used on pickups. The 15 style, the early one, the 10P15C, were used from 84 to roughly mid-1988 before they switched to a newer style compressor. I actually have one of those sitting around here somewhere. This is a 4Runner bracket. These are kind of hard to distinguish, but there are some numbers on there. But that's up until, say, late 87. It's kind of when they switched, because these were all dealer-installed kits. And then there's an even newer style, which I have one kicking around here somewhere, but I don't know. I've managed to collect damn near every style. And then the really rare one, which I do have a friend with one of these, and I can even get it if I want it, is the second gen 4Runner had yet again a larger compressor. It's the 17 series. That refers to the displacement. Bigger displacement, larger compressor, better cooling. But good fucking luck ever finding one of those, because the part number is different. And yeah, I've only ever seen one. So inside here, lighting kind of sucks. This is what you need to do to get to the evaporator assembly, which is this big old box here. They have a bypass thing for non-air-conditioned trucks. I have mine. I think I actually threw mine away because I don't like hot air. But to get to this, you just drop this bracket out, pull the glove box. Takes all of 3 seconds to take it out. And it has this harness on here. You want to try and match the general year of your truck and fuel system type. So EFI with EFI, carb with carb. But all these plug into the factory harness. AC switch, you just punch that little punch out there. It runs over to here. That right there, so the switch plugs into. There's like two plugs on the top here. It's the AC amplifier up there. There is a small knob on it that adjusts the RPM your compressor kicks on at. You really shouldn't have to fuck with that. It should just basically work whenever. Yeah, under the hood electrical here, there's a small jumper harness right next to the fuse box. I apologize for the shitty lighting, but it's this plug here. This is a carbureted one, which is what I'm going over, because it's what I have. And it plugs into this. This is the vacuum switching valve for the idle up. And this other one, which I had to fix because the wire was cut, goes to the compressor clutch. Now, for the idle up, there's this diaphragm here, which hooks onto this linkage, which all these carburetors have, to my knowledge. This is the screw that controls your idle speed. And then there are two screws that go into the side of the carburetor and hold this on. And this vacuum line, that's the vacuum switching valve, which then runs to just the vacuum source here. I put a T on it for the air cleaner. Now, I don't really plan making this a video, so I'm a little unprepared. But after you do that, vacuum it for, at a bare minimum, 30 minutes. It's my recommendation. You can throw a vacuum pump on there and let it just do its thing for an hour or two, if you prefer to get any possible moisture out. I also highly recommend replacing absolutely everything under the sun if you want it to work and work reliably. Also, no fan shroud on here is a big no-no for the performance. And from the factory, they just had foam tucked in around here, so it helps suck more air through the condenser. I will eventually put that in, but I have not done it yet, because there's no huge point in it, because I don't have a fan shroud. Because the original one was broken in 8 pieces and held together with binder clips. So, needless to say, it was in kind of bad shape. So let me plug these vacuum leaks. We'll fire her up, and it cools. And for these R12 systems, if you want to put the adapter fittings on, which, I mean, is how you're supposed to do it. I haven't on this one, because most of the adapter kits don't actually, like, fit these right. God, the struggle's real. Anyways, the big line right there, the one further towards the engine block, that is the low-side air conditioning service port. The high-side port, which is the red one, is the one further towards the inner fender there, which is a small line that goes out to the condenser. So the blue hose goes onto the low side, and the red one goes on the high side. Because the high side is the high pressure side, that is the side after the compressor has built pressure that you are reading. Alright, I got the cap on. This thing is really fucking loud. I think the idler and this is going bad, so it makes grinding noises. And also the idle kicked up really high, because, damn it, I like my air as cold as it'll get. But, so you see, this truck is a perfectly matched interior. Yeah, this truck was ripped out of a field with a seized motor, so it's come a long way. And it had a wonderful mouse nest. So, shut the door. Make sure this is all off. No copyrighted music, even though the radio barely works. Alright, so here we are at idle now, so the system's working right, so this is the blower fan, press the switch, it'll light up, you can hear the idle ramp up, the compressor clutch just kicked on, and now, you can't tell, and I don't have a thermometer, because I have a digital one with a dead battery, but it's cooling down nicely. And if we look under the hood too, you'll see the compressor's running, and since you probably won't be able to hear a thing, I'm going to show the sight glass and the receiver dryer. If it's clear, that is good. It means it is not low in refrigerant. It is, as a general rule of thumb, as a quick diag for something to help with the refrigerant charge. If it's completely clear and the compressor clutch isn't running, there's nothing in there. But if it's running and it's clear with no bubbles, you have a fully charged, fully functional system. So I'll go ahead and show you the compressor run and all that stuff and the sight glass.
super humid out here in Missouri too, so you can see the line is kind of pinching on it. Water on it. So here you go. This is kind of a quick walkthrough on how to install air conditioning. Yeah, this is nice and cold in here.
Turn that off. So yeah, that's air conditioning. I highly recommend putting one of these condensers in. I bought this one through Car ID because, at least right now, they seem to be the most reliable source for these upgrade condensers. They're hit or miss on eBay. Compressor, I highly recommend a newer remanufactured one. Denso is probably preferred. I had this Four Seasons one. It was $350 out the door in stock at AutoZone, so I'm not upset with that. You know, I kind of cried as I swiped my card at the cash register, but it's the box it came in. However, this particular part number on the Advanced Auto website said, when these are out of stock, replace it with something else. So, it's a new compressor instead of a reman, which is super nice. So I'm usually a cheap ass and get remans, but $350 for a brand spanking new one is a pretty good deal, in my opinion. So yeah. These AC systems suffer from poor performance too, because these condensers get worn out. This heater valve here, watch for this, these get stuck in the open position oftentimes, especially non-AC trucks, because people just crank it over and leave it. So make sure that's working, because if not, it won't work as well. Make sure you have foam around the condenser, a good fan clutch, a good fan shroud, and these compressors often wear out, causing your AC to be, you know, mediocre at best in the summer, which makes people mad. So, yeah, those are my general pointers on air conditioning. Feel free to leave any questions. I know a lot about these 1980s Toyota air conditioning systems. I've worked on a lot of them. They're very simple, generally pretty reliable. As long as you go through them and replace the, you know, ancient parts that wear out. So hopefully this helps at least someone. Again, these trucks, they're super easy. Oh, and one other thing I forgot. These holes in the firewall, if you don't have air conditioning originally, they won't be there. There's going to be a divot here, here, and one on the bottom for the evaporative drain tube. You cannot see a thing, but it is down there, I swear. Basically, get a step drill bit and drill them out. They already have divots on the firewall to center them. They're super easy to do. Anyways, though, so this, hopefully it's, you know, I want to cut out this video now so it's not too long and rambly about God knows what. But, yeah, that's air conditioning. It's pretty simple and not that scary. Well, anyways, thank you for watching. Bye.